Yo guys, welcome to RenderRam. My name is Vieku and today I'm gonna be talking about data channel. So recently I made this post on Stack Facebook group where I showed off my procedural Rust with data channel, and apparently a lot of people liked that post. So this is the effect. So this is my kind of pipe with Rust in it, but the cool thing is with data channel I managed to infuse only the Rust parts with extra polygons so that I can have my Rust detailed while everything else is generally, you know, in a lower poly state. So I'm gonna show you three examples here. So this is the first one that you've seen on Stack. So this is like that Rust. So I think it looks generally pretty cool. You can see like all the, you know, extra subdivisions. The next example that I have here is again this same cross, and there is this animating sphere. But when I move the sphere, it's actually deforming the object, and where it deforms the object, it leaves like high poly traces of that area, so you can actually make your own, you know, kind of damages or whatever. Another cool thing is if I resume my render here, you can notice that this is actually leaving a material trace of the damaged part, so you can tune this however you like. And my third example is also a Rust example, but this Rust is actually driven by a map. So I'm using a noise map from Material Editor to kind of drive this noise, and you see how that looks like. It pretty much does serious damage to the whole thing, and again the damaged parts are infused with extra polygons. Okay, so let's start completely fresh. Before we proceed with the whole data channel, I just want to give a shout out to Evermotion because they have Arc Models Volume 293 that's up to 25% off, and it's this beautiful dining furniture. So when you get this pack, you get everything that you see here: props, chairs, dining stuff, whatever, plants, lamps, like you get a pack and you're ready for your dining purposes. So yeah, check out Evermotion website. Their site is regularly updated with all the news, features, articles, tutorials, everything. So let's continue with our data channel. Okay, so let's start completely fresh. I want to add some sort of Rust to this. I'm using Mesh Smooth. There is a reason why I'm using Mesh Smooth. I'm not gonna reveal it now. It's gonna be a surprise later, but you will understand why is it important. So let's add data channel. When you open data channel, generally the main thing where you start, of course you can always start with some presets, but where you start is with the add operators. How do these operators work? Like, what's the whole deal with the operators? You have input operators, process operators, and output operators. So when you're kind of assembling the whole data channel, it always needs to have a starting point, what happens with the object, and how it ends, right? Input is a starting point. Process operators are what happens with the object, and the output is how that, you know, whole thing is gonna be used. So I'm gonna start with, you know, since the Rust is like heavily dependent on corners and that stuff, so I'm gonna start with the curvature. So curvature generally recognizes hard edges, corners, and all that. So as you can see here, you can notice like the faint red area here or blue area there. To kind of pronounce the effect, like when you click on the curvature, you see the options here. I'm just gonna increase my scale to, I don't know, let's say something like this. I just wanna, you know, have it nicely visible. Now, since I'm building an object that will have some sort of deformations, you know how I said that these are starting points, what happens, and these are ending points? It might be very wise for me to add an ending point already, like now, because with that ending point, I'm gonna tell it, show me the final effect. Otherwise, I'm not seeing it. So what I'm gonna do now, I'm gonna add a vertex output because I wanna have a vertex selection for the effects that are happening here. So I'm just gonna grab vertex output and drag it here. Now, as you can see, my cross generally became a pancake. Why? Because when I click on my vertex output, here are the settings or the options of the vertex output. This is what happens with the vertex output. It gives a position of X and it just squashes things. The thing that I need to change this to a vertex selection because I'm interested into modifying a specific selection. So now when I did this, now I can start seeing physical effects happening, but I don't see any. Why? Because this is a selection, and what is above my data channel? You know, like when you like select a couple of polys with edit poly, and then whatever is above that edit poly, like it will only affect those polygons. It's the same thing here. Do I have anything happening after data channel? No. So what I'm gonna do, just gonna go to my previous object here, and I'm gonna copy mesh smooth, noise, and push. So I'm just gonna click those, right click on my data channel, and paste them here. And this is the effect. So these are those three modifiers. Now, these three effects will be visible after data channel. So now when I click on my data channel, and now if I want to play with any of these settings, let's say, for example, curves, you can notice that when I'm moving the convex area, for example, you can see like only things are happening to that convex area. But how the hell do I get that sexy, you know, like mesh smoothing, just piercing the selections there? Well, there is a button in mesh smooth, like I bet you never clicked on it. So when you click on the mesh smooth, you have the apply to whole object. This is the reason, that button is the reason why I'm using mesh smooth, because I haven't seen that button in Turbo Smooth or Open Subdiv. If it is there, please write in the comments. I didn't find it. So when you unclick the apply to whole mesh, look what happens. There is a minor selection created by the data channel, and that selection has my mesh smooth. Look, even if I increase the iterations, it's just gonna infuse the polygons there. Now let's do some controlling of this. So go to your data channel. I have my curvature, and the curvature generally did the effect that I want, but I want this selection. So I want this selection to be much wider, like a bigger selection. So the thing that I'm gonna do, I'm gonna click on add operator, and I'm gonna go to the smooth operator. This one. Smooth, when you drag it here, it doesn't go in the right place for some reason, so just move it up in the middle. Smooth will generally kind of blur out that selection, therefore it's gonna make it actually larger. One thing to mention, you see how these are like those starting operators, and then these ones are what, you know, what happens in the middle, and these are the like the finishing, the ending ones. You see this, there's icons. Like my curvature has an arrow pointing down, and my smooth has a straight line, and my vertex output actually has an arrow that's actually pointing out. So what this happens, curvature is my starting point. It has like a starting, you know, arrow. And then what happens, you know, like any effect that you add are going to be in the form of those vertical lines. And then the last one is just going to be like an out icon, meaning that, you know, this is where it ends. Anyhow, so let's go to our smooth. Now you can just increase the smooth area. You can notice one thing. My sexy subdivision thing kind of disappeared. Why? Because of this. So look at this. When I go to my display settings here, here you've got the color info. It tells you minimum effect, mid effect, and maximum effect. My mesh smooth thing, you know, and all the other effects, they're gonna be visible when the color is absolutely red. So when I went to my smooth and I started to increase it, I generally lost that red color. So what I'm gonna do, I'm just gonna increase the smooth to some size that kind of feels good. And I'm gonna go to my curvature, and since I wanna mess with the convex area, that's the one here in the middle, I'm just gonna move that convex area down. And as you can see, the more I move it down, it's actually being applied to that area that was created by smooth. So look, when I go to the smooth, you can actually see that it kind of borders the whole thing. So like this. So that's it for now. Now, one other thing that you can notice is that if I turn on and off my push here, you can notice that the whole object is actually being pushed a little bit. Like you can even see the noise here. This is supposed to be a straight pipe. So how can you kind of isolate the whole effect only happening to the rusty parts and not the whole thing? You can do that with a curve. So if you go to your process operators, like what happens in the middle, right? There is a curve thing. How does this curve work? From what I understand, correct me if I'm wrong, so I'm just gonna put the curve there. It generally takes this whole thing, like when you go to display, minimum, mid, and max, it takes that whole thing and it can affect those transitions with a curve. But the cool thing is you can clamp certain areas. Like you can say, you know, like until it becomes green, like don't touch anything else. And this is exactly what we are looking for. So look at here. So when you go to the curve, just click on the curve control there and you got this little thingy. So what I did here, I'm just gonna go to the add point, click here, go to the move, and I'm just gonna set this point to be 0. And look what happens. Everything started, you know, everything became blue. What does blue color mean? If you go to the display, that's the minimum, meaning when it's absolutely blue, nothing is happening there. Of course, now you can just add like a bezier smooth to make the, like the whole thing, you know, like bigger or whatever, you know, to like kind of affect the more area. This is the part where you just tweak with it. But this is the deal now. As you can see, push on and off, it just affects this area. It doesn't affect anything else. Even when I unclick everything, you can see that my pipe is absolutely straight, that nothing is happening to that pipe apart from these areas there. And now you can pretty much play with the look how you like it. So you can now interactively just go to push, you know, play with push, make it stronger, weaker, etc. I can maybe, I don't know, make my noise, you know, larger or whatever. You can animate these things here. Like you can have those selections and objects can be like you can have that selection and modifiers can animate stuff through that selection. It's crazy. So I'm just gonna leave it like this. So in my render, I got this. I just have a blank material here and we're gonna add some rustiness to this. So let me just copy my rust color node that I had and I'm just gonna place it here. So this is how I've set it up. So I have a like a mixed material which has, you know, non-rust and rust elements, but I need a mask. As you can see, this selection is not visible in my render. So how do you go about adding, you know, like making that selection visible? Well, you need to go to your data channel again. And now this is what happens. I have a vertex output, which affects vertex selection. But when you go to the drop-down list, you can also have a vertex output that affects, for example, map channel. So what I'm gonna do, I'm just gonna click on add operator, and I'm gonna add another vertex output. And this one will be dedicated only for map channel. So here I'm gonna choose map channel. Okay, so nothing happened. Why? Because our mask texture is still empty. So how I'm gonna go about it, I'm just gonna create a gradient map and I'm gonna plug it into mask texture. And would you look at this, just a gradient map. One thing to notice, when you click on the map channel, you have the channel number. If this number is, for example, 3, you see nothing will happen here, meaning that in your gradient, you need to set this to be a number 3 and then you're gonna get the same effect. Okay, now we just need to tweak our data channel a little bit for this to work nicely. So in the data channel, I'm gonna add a clamp. So clamp will pretty much limit how far a selection can or cannot go. So I'm just gonna drag clamp in between these two vertex outputs like this. And now the default values are minimum 5,000, maximum 5,000. The numbers that you need are pretty much 0 and 1. So what I'm gonna do, I'm just gonna set my minimum to be 0 and I'm gonna set my maximum to be 0.99. And as you can see, it works. Why 0.99? Because if it's 1, I still get that effect. So I just place 0.99 there. Okay, and now, you know, to make this whole thing look much more cooler, I'm just gonna clone this mix. I'm gonna set this color to be completely white. I'm gonna set this color to be completely black. And I'm generally just gonna use, you know, a noise here, which I will plug, let's say here. I think this is the right thing to, yeah. So I plugged it in here and it started affecting the area here. So I'm just gonna choose a type of noise to, let's say, this one. And go into my material settings. You can now increase the bump on it, etc. And you've got this effect. Reduce my glossy a little bit just to make it, you know, more kind of matte. I can play with the size of that noise a little bit more and we got this effect. And that is pretty much it. This is how I created this whole effect. Look, you got this nice rust. If you want to kind of manipulate that rust and how that looks like, you can always go to, like I said, you know, you can go to your modifiers and just tweak them more, you know, like make it more decaying or whatever. So now if I want to kind of, you know, make this whole selection a little bit weaker because I think it, like, the rust is just overly affecting things, what you can do, you can go to your data channel and just smash a smooth operator. So when you click on the smooth, you just drag it there. Of course, it's not going to be placed correctly, so you put it here and you just blur out this selection. So just blur it out like this, although it does create a cool effect, but it kind of does the opposite from, you know, from what we wanted. But at this point you can just go to your gradient, and in your gradient you can just do these manual contrasts. So I'm just going to create this one and put this one to black, use this one, put this one to pure white. And now you can just, as you can see, you can now just contrast these sections and they're just gonna appear smaller and smaller, and that's generally how you can control how much of it you want it to kind of affect the whole thing. Okay, so now let me just show you how I quickly made the other two, and I'm gonna show you some maneuvers that you can do. So we got the first one that was rust, that's my original one that I showed. Now we got the next one, which had, you know, this thing where the ball can just follow things and deform stuff. So what I used here in my data channel, I used a starting point. I didn't use a curvature for a starting point. I used a node influence. When you click on the node influence, I chose my sphere here, and that sphere pretty much acts as this giant selection that's just going around and around. But what I did, I added a decay effect. What decay does, it will remember the path where the sphere went, and that's how I got those traces. So with the decay, it kind of, you know, remembers where things went. Cool thing about the decay is you can actually make things to unselect themselves over time. So for example, you can make like traces in the snow, and then they're just, you know, coming back to the original shape, or on the sand, on the beach, or whatever. Decay is cool. And on the third one, I, again, it's a very, very similar procedure where I just used distort, again, instead of curvature. And in the distort as my starting point, I plugged in a noise texture. So look at it. This is my noise here. So that's the noise that's plugged into there. So now if I increase the size of my noise, you can see how this whole thing is generally get like being affected only by a map. You can like use the phase just to kind of move things around or whatever, you know, it's a very cool thing. But one thing that's very awesome is you can now use this data channel option. So here I use data channel, mesh smooth, push, noise. So I'm gonna grab all four of them, right click, gonna go to my first rusty pipe, and I'm just gonna paste these over. So I'm gonna have a double data channel, which will be combined with my previous data channel. Now, one thing that you can notice, the rust part here is not really visible anymore. Like it's not visible in the texture. Why? Because in this data channel, so like in generally what happened is a clash of map channels. So like my first data channel has a vertex output here, that's a map channel. And then this data channel has that same vertex output, that's a map channel, and one override, like overridden the other. So what do you do in the second data channel? You wanna change the selection method to add. Now this adds this channel on top of the existing channel, and now we got our rust here. And yeah, that's the shit that you can do with data channel. It's freaking awesome. Just hope this video doesn't last for 5 hours. If I feel like I'm recording forever. And that's it for today, guys. I hope you kind of understood data channel. It really has a steep learning curve. The biggest problem is like, the more you work in it, the more you don't know what's happening, but more things are starting to sit in place. It's hard to learn. It's not easy, but I think it's worth it. Now you can experiment this with like various different things. Like I would do like some wall corners. I even infused, like when I would do a sofa, I would infuse like turbo smooth or mesh smoothing around the stitches so that I can create like micro wrinkles there, but not on the entire thing. I don't know, it's very dope. Thank you for watching, and see you in the next video. Bye.